Members, good morning. May I call to order meeting of the Public Service Panel. The first item on the agenda is application for late membership. Subsequent to the last meeting, we received an application from Mr. Lok Chung Hong asking to join our panel. The meeting was dated the 16th of December. Please refer to paper CB4177/1920-01. All right, members, do you accept Mr. Lok Chung Hong's application? Any objection, please? No, then the application is unanimously accepted. The second thing on the agenda, information papers issued since the last regular meeting. We have two. One from Dr. Chiang Lai-wan and Ms. Elizabeth QUAT, requesting the panel to discuss the enactment of legislation to prohibit acts of insulting public officers at a future meeting in this session. And the letter is from Mr. Lam Cheuk-ting, dated the 3rd of October, on the Civil Service Bureau's policy relating to the expression of political stance of civil servants and requesting the panel to discuss the issue at a future meeting. On the 4th of November, the panel discussed various items for discussion, and on the 11th of November, together with the Deputy Chairman, I had a working meeting with the Secretary for CS to reflect members' proposals to the Secretary, and the proposals have been included into our list of outstanding items for discussion. Now, for the matters referred to by the two letters, they've been included as number 15 and 19 of our list of outstanding items for discussion, respectively. So please refer to the list. Dr. Chiang. Thank you, Chairman. Although you've already added my suggestion to the list, very often the items are only listed there. Can you please ask the Secretary categorically when papers can be available from the Secretary for discussion in this panel? Can you wait a moment, Dr. Chiang? I will invite the Secretary to come in and answer your question directly. Please invite the administration to join us.
Good
morning, Secretary and PS. Just now, Dr. Chiang Lai-wan asked whether we can discuss the enactment of legislation to prohibit acts of insulting public officers within this session. Thank you. The Security Bureau has just completed its study and is now consulting the DFJ's advice. And the next step is to consult relevant policy bureaus when the matter is ready. We will consult members. I apologize to Dr. Chiang. I cannot give any time frame today. Dr. Chiang, according to the Secretary, is there any possibility that we can discuss this issue within this session? I don't want to make any guess, wild guess. But as soon as the item is ready, we will come to the panel. All right. I'm sure the Secretary treasure the 400,000-odd public officers we have in Hong Kong. And we have a freedom of expression in Hong Kong to the extent that people can use a most insulting, offensive language in the face of public officers. So I hope that the secretary can protect his public officers and legislate on such matter ASAP to restore the dignity of our public officers. Dr. Chiang, this year is the last year of this term of the council, so I'm quite anxious as well. I hope we can discuss this matter within this term, given that time is running out. So can we put this question to the secretary every time we meet? I agree, secretary. I mean, chairman. All right, any other questions on the second item? If not, we move on to item three. Date of our next meeting and also the agenda. Please refer to the list of outstanding items and also the progress report. The next meeting is scheduled for the 20th of January 2020 at 10:45. Please jot it down. Yes. At the last meeting, we discussed having a public hearing on grade structure review of discipline services. We would like to consult the trade unions and associations of the civil service. And so, members, do you agree that this too will be the agenda for our next meeting? Dr. Chiang, chairman. I am more concerned about the doctors of our hospitals under the hospital authority. The pay scale and also the grade structure of medical officers in the HA follow that of the Department of Health. However, when doctors leave the HA and join the private sector, they can earn many times more, and the salaries from the HA are not competitive enough. I have every respect for doctors who remain to serve the HA. Is there anything we can do to compensate the situation? Secretary. We have, you're talking about doctors employed by the hospital authority. Well, I'm afraid that is not under the portfolio of the Civil Service Bureau. I think you have to put a question to the HA or the Food and Health Bureau. Now, according to the HA, they follow the pay structure or pay scale of the government. Well, the hospital authority is an independent public body. It can deal with as doctors according to their employment relations, and sometimes they may make reference to the government's pay structure, and sometimes it can. It also has a full autonomy. So, if no objection, or it is none of your business. All right, I already get that. All right, secretary, please be more direct. Can you have any say over the pay received by doctors of HA? I don't think I can because it's the decision of the HA. All right, noted. Dr. Chiang, I think you have to raise this at the health services panel for sure. Thank you. Mr. Lam Cheuk-ting, Chairman, I'd like to comment on the proposed agenda for the next meeting. Previously, I wrote a letter to the secretary on the question of political neutrality of civil servants and civil servants are making public comments to criticize either government officials or demonstrators. Many frontline civil servants are subject to disciplined hearings because of making comments on the social media, but for the FSD head, he has openly called demonstrators cockroaches. So can we have a meeting as soon as possible to discuss how should political neutrality of civil servants be construed? Because many frontline police officers have got a Weibo accounts in the mainland criticizing the most senior echelons of the government. So should we discuss this matter so that you can tidy up, you can put your house in order? Mr. Lam Cheuk-ting, perhaps you were late, but I already helped you. I already mentioned your letter, and then it is now on the list of outstanding items. You might want to come earlier next time, but I'll see if the Secretary would like to respond. Thank you, Chairman. We have got a letter from Mr. Lam Cheuk-ting, and I'd like to point out that we won't, and it's also inappropriate to openly comment on individual cases. On the question of political neutrality of civil servants, we have got policies and codes and guidelines. We'll provide a written reply to Mr. Lam Cheuk-ting's question. All right, Mr. Lam, please wait until you have got his reply. I have already received his reply and I'm not happy with it. So, Mr. Lam Cheuk-ting, have you received any personal letter? Because we have not received any official reply from the Secretary. According to the Secretary, he's going to give you another reply, so let's wait. All right, I will wait for Mr. Law's reply. Ms. Elizabeth Quat, I welcome the proposal to discuss grade structure review of discipline services at the next meeting, because we have fought for that for a long time, and I hope that the outcome of the GSR is favorable. The reason why we want to do a GSR is to boost the morale of the discipline services, but as we all know, the morale of the police has been dealt a serious blow because they've been subject to insults too often. So I want to discuss the proposed legislation to prohibit acts of insulting public officers as soon as possible so that public officers can carry out their duty with dignity. Thank you. Ms. Quat, you were also late. Dr. Zhang Lai-wan, who jointly sent that letter to us with you, has already raised this issue, and I understand that the Security Bureau is now conducting a study, and we will ask the Secretary every time we meet with him. Thank you. All right, any other views on the agenda for our next meeting? No, then that's it. We move on to item 4. Members, show of hands please if you would like to ask questions. And that is overview of medical and dental benefits for civil servants, pensioners, and eligible dependents.
The administration's paper is CB4177/1920/04. The electrical secretariat has prepared a background brief, and that is (05). So over to you, Secretary, please walk us through the paper. Thank you, Chairman. We issued the paper to the panel to brief members on the government's position as the employer of civil servants in providing civil service medical benefits to civil servants. We're going to to focus on two service providers, that is the Department of Health and the Hospital Authority, in the upcoming Enhanced Services Initiative. There are at the moment 6 families clinics provided by the Department of Health, covering Hong Kong Island, Kowloon, and New Territories West and East, and also North District. The latest families clinics in Sai Kung commenced service in December 2018. We've also started the planning work for the seven families clinics in Chiang Kwan Lo and also the other one in Kwun Tong. Next year in March, the Department of Health will provide some new services, including an integrated care program for patients with diabetes in families clinics, and also for patients of chronic diseases, there will also be the stable drug use pilot program. For dental services, in the beginning of next year, the newly commissioned West Kowloon Government Complex in government offices in Yau Ma Tei, there will be a new dental clinic, a general dental clinic, GDC, with 16 general dental surgeries. And to shorten the waiting time for specialized dental services, starting from 2018-19, the DH by phases would provide 11 specialized dental surgeries, and with full operation of these 11 surgeries, it is expected that an additional capacity of 18,000 attendances will be provided each year. The HA also plays a very important role in providing medical services for civil service and eligible persons. The government, as the employer of civil servants, has all along been enlisting the support of hospital authority in providing specialist outpatient clinics and also imaging services. At the moment, at three HA hospitals, the HA provides service, special services for civil servants and also imaging centers for civil servants to enhance the service quality. This year in March, we already extended the service hours of magnetic resonance imaging MRI service and introduced mammographic service at the imaging center, and also to enhance the priority disk arrangement for civil servants in GOPCs, general outpatient clinics under HA, starting from this year. Under among six GOPCs, a new program has been put in place to redistribute the priority disks, such that disks in clinics with low demand were redistributed in to those with higher demand, so that resources can be better utilized. This arrangement of redistribution will also be extended to another six GOPCs starting from April next year to further enhance the priority disk arrangement, so that needy civil servants can receive the free medical service as soon as possible. Apart from providing the above services, we will continue to reimburse medical expenses to CSEPs as part of the medical benefits package. In 2014-15, the actual expenditure was $400 million. The revised estimate for 2017-18, the cost had increased to $760 million. And in 2019-20, it has been increased to $1.1011 billion, a 100% increase comparing to the previous year. Our next initiative will be to provide Chinese medical services. The chief executive announced in her policy address 2018 that Chinese medicine will be introduced as part of civil service medical benefits, and providing Chinese medicine services to CSEPs is a new initiative. We plan to introduce a pilot scheme to gauge the long-term sustainability of the service. We will set up such a clinic at two Chinese Medicine Centers for Teaching and Research, CMCTRs, in two hospitals, namely Eastern District of Hong Kong Island, that's Pamela Yu Nethso Eastern Hospital, and Chun Wan of New Territories, Yan Chai Hospital, to provide free Chinese medicine general consultation and acupuncture services to CSEPs. The pilot scheme is expected to be launched in March next year, and the annual service quota will be around 63,000. And we'll closely monitor the situation and plan the scheme for the long term. We'll continue to work closely with the Department of Health and Hospital Authority to further enhance the medical benefits and facilities for civil service for CSEPs. That concludes my presentation, Chairman. Thank you. I'll give the floor to members to ask questions. 5 minutes questions and answers included. We have Chen Chenying, Ho Kai Ming, Wen Xiuping, Elizabeth Quat, Eunice Yong, and Michael Look, Ronick Chen. Thank you, Chairman. First question about reimbursement of medical services. According to your paper, paragraph 10, in 2020, the amount will be increased to $1.1011 billion. And this year, the cost was just some $760 million. And then the previous year is $670 million. And can you account for the substantial increase? Because even with dental services and Chinese medicine services, they shouldn't account for such a big increase. And paragraph 6 also referred to the enhancement of priority disk arrangement for civil servants. 73 GOP seats and 65 of which have reserved priority disks for serving civil servants. Now, it has been in place for 2 months or so. Have you assessed the impact on the public queue? Has any complaint been received from any member of the public about the priority disk arrangement for civil servants? Third question about Chinese medicine services. It is said that it will be launched in March 2020 with a service quota of about 63,000. We have only two hospitals, that is the Eastern Hospital in Eastern District of Hong Kong Island and Yan Chai Hospital of Chun Wan of the New Territories included in the pilot scheme. We talked about the Cheung Kwan O Hospital as well, and we also talked about another proposal of allowing reimbursement of medicine medical fees from using private sector services. Will you consider these two suggestions? And will you consider including the third hospital in your pilot scheme? Secretary, I'll try to answer the first and the third question, and then my colleague can answer the question about priority disk arrangement. About reimbursement of medical expenses, this is completely demand-driven. So if there is a greater demand from civil servants, and if HA is unable to provide the required medication, and if it is found to be necessary, then it will be covered. But it is hard to give a fixed quota or determine the annual service level. That depends on the actual case demand. Is it that there is an increase in demand because of more civil servants utilizing the service? That this could be possible. About the next question, and under the pilot scheme, two hospitals will be covered. That is the Eastern Hospital and Chun Wan Yan Chai Hospital. The clinics will be set up in the two CMCTRs, and we will review the pilot scheme and also consider expanding the network. Of course, our ultimate goal is to expand the network to cover more areas. At this moment, We will first focus on the pilot scheme, and then we will conduct a review, and we don't rule out including more districts depending on the supply of service providers and other objective conditions.
陳議員答曬你嘅問題未啊？仲有一條啊。
Have you answered all his questions? Not yet. Right, priority disk. I'll ask my colleague to answer. Well, this priority disk arrangement, in fact, is not a new scheme. It has been in place for many years. We have at the moment 73 GOPCs under the HA. 65 of them have provided priority disk for serving civil servants so that they can receive medical treatment and return to work if considered fit as early as possible. And these GOPCs reserved around 558,000 priority disks for civil servants. That's about 10% of the total disks available. As for fine-tuning and redistributing priority disks, during the daytime, some clinics may have low use of priority disks. And anyway, we have instructed the HA to monitor very closely the effectiveness of the redistribution effort and the impact on the public queue. I understand that, Mr. Chen. Next, Mr. Ho Kai-ming. Thank you, Chairman. I'm very happy to hear that service to civil servants is demand-driven. I think many civil servants would like to have reimbursement of their medical service expenses so that they are not confined to visiting GOPCs. It's really an embarrassment because I heard from a senior civil servant that the public at the clinic would have the impression that we are taking resources away from them. We understand that this is provided as additional medical benefit for civil servants. The public's perception, however, is that we are jumping the queue. So if indeed it is demand-driven, please heed the civil services view and allow reimbursement of medical expenses. Chinese medicine services, I think there is a breakthrough, and we're happy to hear that. I understand that there are additional quotas currently available in these CMCTRs so that there will not be a squeeze of resources. We'd like the administration to expedite their thinking process so that more quotas can be created. Another point is we can have outsourcing of Chinese medicine services. For example, some organizations provide mobile Chinese medicine services. We have such a large pool. Perhaps we can introduce something like that as well. For example, near government offices where there tend to be more civil servants, we can engage a doctor and we can arrange the service once a week. And if it's effective, you can increase the service frequency so as to increase the service level, because according to the CSR, the medical services provided to civil servants should not be worse than before 1997. We need to keep up with the times, and at the moment it is not really desirable. In order to retain quality civil servants, the government as the employer should think about it.
I hope you can employ more methods to deal with this. So what's your question? At locations where there are more civil servants working, perhaps you can have outreaching Chinese medicine services, because many civil servants would like to consult Chinese medical doctor. It's just that services are not available. So if you consider this, you don't have enough service points. Can civil servants procure services in the private sector and have the fees reimbursed. We have not considered this possibility yet. We didn't use to provide Chinese medicine services for civil servants. This is entirely new, and therefore the approach and also the method of delivery. Now we are carrying out a pilot scheme, and the proposals by Mr. Ho can be studied. We also have to consider the quality of services. It can really achieve our objective by deploying a vehicle there, and we need to monitor the quality. However, when we review the effectiveness of the pilot scheme, we can take into account various suggestions. For those who have served in the districts, I can tell you that many NGOs, including Bokoi, have been providing Chinese medicine services in vehicles. The problem is mainly power supply. Now, if CGO has got thousands of civil servants as potential clients, I don't see how this is going to be difficult. I'm not saying that the vehicle should be deployed throughout the week. You can ask it to come a day a week, and then you can ask the INT fund to give you $1 million to run the trial scheme. And Chunwan and the Eastern District, you know, the two CMCTRs are rather remote. In Chunwan and also the Eastern District. So can you consider my suggestion? Yes, after we have run the pilot scheme for 1 year, we will consider this possibility. Since Mr. Pun Xiuping is not here, I'll give the floor to Ms. Elizabeth Quat first. Thank you. Of course, we welcome the government's move to provide Chinese medicine services to civil servants. They have been waiting for that for a long time. Now you only have two pilot points in Eastern District of Hong Kong Island and Chunwan of the NT. Can you offer more choices to benefit more civil servants? Because Chunwan is quite remote to many civil servants. And my second question relates to retired civil servants. They will no longer be entitled to medical services after they retire. The disciplined services would want the administration to consider a voluntary medical insurance suggestion from the disciplined services so that they can start to take out medical insurance as early as possible, so that they can start using medical services in the private sector even now, and then they will continue to enjoy coverage after retirement. I understand that they already submitted a proposal to the SB and CSB. I'd like to know the government's view on that. I do support the proposal, in particular with increasing social conflicts. Now, let me reiterate once again that I believe most medical and healthcare staff are very professional, but some of them do have very strong political inclinations. And some police officers and their family members are very worried when it comes to patronizing public hospitals. So I hope you can seriously consider the medical insurance proposal from the disciplined services. I'd like to know the secretary's view, please. Thank you. Regarding the location of the two CMCTRs, we note this point too, and when identifying the right places for the pilot scheme, we tried to source one in Kowloon, but I'm sorry. Now, we wanted to wait until the whole plan is very comprehensive, but then that would delay the launching of the scheme. So we will start with Hong Kong Island and NT first, and we'll very proactively try to identify suitable location in the in Kowloon to provide similar services. As regards medical insurance, this will be a major policy change involving huge financial resources. We are using services from the Hospital Authority and the Department of Health to enhance our service capacity to meet service needs. When it comes to insurance, medical insurance, now the greatest difference with the current mode of services, we are now providing comprehensive and free medical services. When it comes to medical insurance, there is a limit to the coverage, and it can never replace the comprehensive services from HA and DH. So we have to be very cautious in considering such a proposal, and we need to take into account financial implications to the government. Ms. QUAT talked about problems faced by members of the disciplined services when consulting HA clinics and hospitals. HA has already reminded their professional staff to uphold professional integrity and conduct, and they must treat all patients impartially without any differential treatment. And I understand that HA attaches a lot of significance to this subject, so that all public officers, including police officers, will get the most appropriate treatment they need. Of course, this is a good intention. The secretary said that members of the civil service and discipline services have access to free medical services. In fact, this is not entirely true, because you have an estimate, you have a budget, and the fact is our public hospitals are already working at they're already saturated. And then if there can be alternatives from other hospitals for the discipline services, that can alleviate the burden of the hospital authority, and that can also address the concerns of some members of the discipline services and their family members. So please don't say no to the proposal so early. Give them further consideration. Well, we provide a lump sum allocation to the hospital authority. We cannot break it down as to which portion is for members of the public or which portion is for the civil service. That being the case, if we provide extra resources to provide medical services in the form of medical insurance, to a large extent, that would mean duplication of resources. Even if our colleagues receive treatment in the private sector, because there are exclusions in insurance coverage, and ultimately they may come back for services from the hospital authority, and that would be serious duplication of resources. I think this goes against the government's principle of promoting voluntary health insurance. The government understands that when it comes to major operations, members of the public will come back to the hospital authority, but for other diseases, they can receive treatment in the private sector. I hope the Secretary can think out of the box. While we cannot reach any conclusion today, I hope the Secretary can give serious consideration to this proposal. Thank you. Mr. Bun Xiuping, thank you. I have met with the joint conference for medical services for the civil service. I have discussed with the Secretary a number of times this issue. Indeed, provision of medical services is part of the employment package of the civil service, and we've also seen improvements from the government recently. Now, I understand that there will be two more families clinics in Chang Kwan O and Kun Tong on the drawing board soon. I'd like to know the actual progress. Do you have any target service commencement dates, including the employment of manpower to man the new families clinics? And now in paragraph 5, you talked about how to enhance civil servants' ability to cope with stress. I understand the clinical psychological services are available. Recent social incidents might have substantially added to the stress of civil servants. So will you consider enhancing clinical psychological services for civil servants as a result? And as for dental services, I understand that three new surgeries will be opened and you can provide a treatment slots of 18,000 odd per year as a result of the new dental surgeries. But 18,000 attendances, that would mean about 50 attendances per day. And this year, your priority will be, or rather you, a highlight of your services to provide Chinese medicine services. They will be launched in March next year, and you expect and to provide an annual service quota of about 63,000, that is 80 per day. And then the management will be on a tripartite basis. I'd like to know whether a consultation and dispensary services will be the same as that for the CMCTRs. Thank you. I'll invite my colleagues to supplement on dental and psychological services for the civil service. I thank Mr. Poon for your recognition of our efforts in trying to enhance medical and dental services for the civil service. What you said was very encouraging. The 7th Families Clinic will be opened in Chang Kwan O. It is under planning. We expect to start the preparation in 2020, because it will be established in the new government offices, and which will commence construction in 2020 for completion in 2025.
After the government offices building is completed, we can set up a clinic there. As for the 8th Families Clinic in Kun Tong, we plan to include this in the future Civil Service Academy building, which is expected to be completed in 2026. So the timetable is roughly 2026. We expect to be able to provide the 8th Families Clinic by then. Chinese medicine services. This is a new scheme. So we are engaging two of the 18 CMCTRs with experience to implement the tripartite model. We have the HA, the universities, as well as the subvented organization. Please allow me to finish to provide this service. The mode of service will be similar to what is provided under the CMCTRs at the moment. The consultation rooms and other facilities, however, will be dedicated to civil servants only. So in selecting pilot sites, we need to make sure they have the space instead of relying on existing facilities and resources. We don't want to be seen to be competing with the public for resources. As for dental and psychological services, let me see if my colleague will supplement. For specialized dental services, we are making progress. For orthodontics, restorative orthodontics or prosthodontic services, the waiting time has been shortened from 33 months to 10 to 12 months. As for periodontal services, they have also consolidated resources. For first appointment, the waiting time has been shortened from 13 to 26 months to 10 to 17 months. We provide services to relieve stress of civil servants stemming from work. Under the Civil Service Bureau, we engage the Hong Kong Christian Family Services to provide counseling. Apart from a hotline counseling service, we can also have face-to-face interviews, and we can also have referral services to other departments for treatment. We also hold workshops. Civil servants are welcome. As for families, clinics, referral, clinical psychological services are also available. In 2018, we provided 2,200 attendances and also about 100 education activities. Usually, within 4 weeks, a new patient should be able to book a first appointment. Next, Ms. Eunice Yong. Thank you, Chairman. The government, as the employer of civil servants, is obliged to honor the contractual spirit and provide medical services for civil servants. In the past 2 years, I understand that the government has stepped up services, including medical and dental services, and as well as Chinese medicine services. So we've made progress, but the overall problem is that the waiting time is too long. For a specialist service, sometimes the wait could be as long as a year or two. I understand priority is given to civil servants, and I wonder if this is true. I read from the paper that there is a paragraph about enhancement of priority disk arrangement for civil servants, but does it cover all sorts of services, or does it also relate to, say, the availability of hospital beds and medical staff? Let me turn to this paragraph. Enhancement of priority disks arrangement for civil servants. Has the government considered using big data or other computer systems to deal with the arrangement of disks for civil servants? For example, if at one clinic all the disks have been distributed, can civil servants then rely on the computer system and opt for another clinic so that they can receive service as soon as possible? Because that's from your paper, you would like civil servants if considered fit, to be able to return to work as early as possible. So have you considered relying on computerized systems in distributing quotas or discs? Next point is about dental services. In the coming year, I understand that there will be 3 more surgeries with an additional capacity of 18,000 attendances. However, this won't come on stream until a few years later. Is that really a match with the actual demand? Because for prosthodontic services, it is impossible to wait for 3 years. Third question about insurance. Other members have spoken on the point, and according to civil service unions, they've reflected this concern to us. I, however, don't understand the government's point. Why can't it be implemented? Because even for services for the public, you can have public-private partnership as well. It is pointless just to continue to increase quota in the public system. There is also a brain drain of doctors in public health care. So why don't you do more to enhance public-private partnership? Because, for example, some discipline services unions have suggested voluntary health insurance schemes so that we can divert the queue to the private sector. Of course, this doesn't fully address the problem. Some civil servants will, after all, opt for public service. At least you can divert the queue and reduce the queue to a certain extent. Maybe the secretary can take the lead in improving public-private partnership arrangements, say on the provision of dental services, Chinese medicine services. You can have PPP. And also reimbursement of medical expenses for those who have gone to private sector for Chinese medicine services, because you mentioned the families clinics in Chiang Kwan O and also only 2 Chinese medicine centers in remote locations. Please explain to me why insurance doesn't work. Secretary, about big data. We can bring this view back to the HA for further discussion and see whether technology can be deployed in distributing discs. I want to emphasize, however, for civil servants' discs in 2018, for example, the number of attendances was 358,000. 66% of all the priority discs available. In other words, we have yet to reach capacity. But of course, we can consider the idea of big data and how we can further help with the distribution. Dental services. For general dental services, the number of dental surgeries increased from 167 to some 240. 10 years on, an increase of 200%, and prosthodontic services, the increase was 31%. That's about dental surgeries. We will continue to plow in more resources to improve services. Despite the huge improvements we have made in the past decade, about further improvement to medical services, I think you made a valid point. The biggest constraint is, in fact, the number of public doctors. The HA, as well as the administration, have strived by introducing different measures to, for example, recruit more public doctors and increase the number of training places in the 2 universities. I understand the member's point. You would like to have enhanced PPP. We note your view. In terms of our policy and use of resources, we need a more in-depth and comprehensive study on our way forward. I'm afraid at this moment, therefore, we cannot give you a whole answer. At the moment, we are still of the view that we should try to give provide services in the public system as much as we can, and for additional resources, as they become available, we believe to a large extent it will also help a lot. As for whether insurance schemes should be taken out, we need to take an in-depth study before we give you any final answer. Thank you. In order for us to stick to our schedule and move on to the next item, I need to ask whether any members have further questions on this paper. If not, I'll draw a line here. We have Michael Lok, Peter Shiu, and myself, the three more members to speak. Thank you, Chairman. Apart from having concern for civil servants, I'm also concerned about another group of employees serving the public, and that is the NCSC, non-civil servant service contract staff, and also the outsourced staff. They have no protection at all, and they have no promotional prospect. We are against the whole NCSC system as a whole. But if the situation is such that NCSC or outsourced staff are required, we need to provide reasonable benefits. Of course, what we want is ultimately equal pay. We believe that this could be done because, Chairman, like my ward office, our team would take out medical insurance for employees. We're talking about a premium of several thousand dollars a year. I don't see how the government will not be able to shoulder the cost for some 50,000 or 60,000 outsourced and NCSC staff. The government isn't really so deprived as not being able to afford the premium. By taking out insurance for them, the government can show commitment and provide real benefits to them so that they won't be the end without. Your response, Secretary? Well, for NCSC and outsourced staff, I think we can have a more detailed discussion at the next item. But I'm focusing on medical benefits. Yes, I'm just saying that the next item also involves NCSC. Now, the mode of employment is such that no additional medical dental services will be provided. It comes as a package. I don't think we can compare the conditions of service between civil servants and other organizations. No direct comparison should be made.
Now, for NCSC staff, they enjoy maternity leave and other benefits. So if they have served for at least 4 weeks before their confinement date, then entitled before they start their maternity leave, they are entitled to 14 weeks of maternity leave, just like their civil service counterparts. And for medical insurance, we have reservation. We do not have any basis to discuss how we can provide medical services with medical insurance. So we have no intention to provide medical insurance coverage for a non-civil service staff. Now, when it comes to why can't you compare NCS staff as to civil service staff, because they are serving the government, and in fact we have seen some improvements in the terms of NCSC staff. For instance, very soon they're able to enjoy 17 days of general public holidays. So we want you to gradually improve their benefits, even if you cannot take out individual insurance coverage for them. Can you provide general contractor so that they can patronize private sector service providers? And Secretary, yes, we have reminded government departments that wherever possible, they should see whether they can, on a discretionary basis, provide enhanced benefits to NCSC staff. And we will ask them to review the terms on a regular basis to ensure that our terms and conditions are competitive with the private sector. Thank you. Mr. Xu Kafei. Thank you. So this topic is about medical and dental benefits for civil servants. Para 13 is about Chinese medicine services. Now, it is said here that the CE announced in her 2018 policy address that Chinese medicine will be introduced for the civil service. We welcome that. And that starting from March 2020, an annual service quota of around 63,000 will be provided. I'd like to know whether the 63,000 refers to a headcount or number of attendances. Is number of attendances? There are about 560,000 ESPs, CSEPs, and yet you're only providing annual service quota of 63,000. You know, for each disease, you have to make several visits to the Chinese medicine medical practitioners, and sometimes for improvement of general health, you may need to see a Chinese medical practitioner for half a year. So how did you set this service quota of 63,000? Thank you, Mr. Xiu. The provision of Chinese medicine services is on a pilot basis. You cannot just consider the total number of CSEPs. And we want to launch the service as soon as possible. So soon after the CE announced the introduction of Chinese medicine as part of the civil service medical benefits, we started to identify appropriate service providers and locations. So far, we have identified two CMCTRs, and based on the capacity of these two centers, we've come up with this service quota of 63,000. I entirely understand that this is far from sufficient, but these are just two pilot points. And after completion of the pilot scheme, we'll see how services can be expanded to other districts. We'll see whether there is room for more Chinese medicine services to be provided. Thank you. One will be provided in the Eastern District of Hong Kong, Pam Ly Yut, Netherton Eastern Hospital, and the other one is Yen Chai Hospital in Chun Wan of the NT. I'm sure that each clinic has got its service capacity. Now, we welcome the provision of Chinese medicine to civil servants And as a start, I understand that the pilot scheme will try to ascertain the take-up rate, and so you should check the popularity of such services. And if the response is very encouraging, you may want to expand the pilot scheme. I understand that the Chung Hwa Group of Hospitals also provide Chinese medicine services. They have liaison with traders of Chinese medicine services, and there may be Chinese medical practitioners available in the private sector, and you can use a similar devices such as medical vouchers. I think many Chinese medicine clinics have been well established with a very good reputation. So please review the pilot scheme in due course. Okay, thank you. All right, we want to leave time for the next agenda item. So I will not ask questions myself, and we will go on to the next item. Non-civil service contract staff. The administration has provided paper CB4177/19/20/06, and our secretariat has prepared paper /07 for us. In early November, Mr. Yip Kin Yun asked the administration to provide information on the number of contract staff employed by different bureaus and departments, and to ask departments employing more than 1,000 contract staff to be in attendance. So the administration has already provided a reply. All right, in addition to the papers by the administration and the secretariat, under this item, we've already got a response from the administration. So, in response to Mr. Yip's request, the secretaries has invited representatives from the Hong Kong Post and the EMSD to be present. Thank you. Thank you. We report on a regular basis to this panel the number of NCSC staff employed. I will just issues raised by members in the past, and also some measures already taken by the administration. Now, we've issued very clear guidelines to different departments on employment of NCSC staff, and then the NCSC positions should be ones that are time-limited, seasonal, or subject to market fluctuations, B, requiring staff to work less than the conditioned hours of civil servants, C, need to tap the latest expertise in a particular area of the labor market, or D, involves service, the mode of delivery of which is under review or is likely to be changed. Given the nature of the concerned task, it is appropriate for the government to employ NCSC staff instead of civil servants for them, because NCSC staff can provide more flexibility for departments to take care of their operational and service needs. Now, for the first three types of positions I just mentioned, that is those that are time-limited, seasonal, or subject to market fluctuations, those who require staff to work less than the conditioned hours of civil servants, and those that need to tap the latest expertise in a particular area of the labor market, they cannot be replaced by civil service posts. It's only the last category, that is, those that may be replaced by civil servants after review, can they be replaced by civil service posts? So there is a need for NCAC positions to remain. Now, I'd like to report to you changes in our NPSC positions. As at June 30th, 2019, 10,444 full-time NCAC staff have been employed, down 8,100 positions compared with the same period last year, or 44%. Compared with the same period in 2018, there was an increase of 670, or around 7%. There was an increase in the number of NCAC staff last year because of some time-limited or one-off large-scale tasks taken forward in 2019, and so hundreds of contract staff had to be employed. And they include a caring and sharing scheme, territory-wide identity card replacement exercise, and election-related work. When these projects are completed, the NCSC positions will be removed. So if we discount the three large-scale tasks I just mentioned, the total number of NCSC staff employed this year is 310, or 3% lower than what was employed last year. We have been asking government departments to review their positions time and again. So for positions that for work that has to be done in the long term, the positions are being replaced by civil servants. In the past 13 years, we have seen 8,000 odd positions being replaced by civil service posts. Members have raised several concerns about the NTSC staff scheme. I'd like to respond here. Some members expressed concern about the long tenure of NCSC staff. According to a survey done in mid-2019, situation has continued to improve. We have about 3,310 being employed for more than 5 years, down 30% compared with the historical peak in 2013. Some 30% of them have served in different NCSC positions without a break in service, instead of taking the same positions all along. In fact, many of the positions are meant to provide services that are subject to market fluctuations, or those that cannot be provided by civil servants. So for positions or service needs that are being reviewed or is likely to be changed, now take public libraries or positions. Example, we have seen some of the positions being replaced by civil service posts. We closely follow up their situation with colleagues to discuss with departments from time to time related issues. In particular, with positions with departments with more NCSC posts or that have been employing NCSC staff for a long tenure, we've already encouraged them to review the situation and try to replace NCSC staff with civil service posts as far as possible. So we have seen a continuous decline in the number of NCSC staff, and we will continue to follow up.
Members have also shown concern about NCSC staff applying for open recruitment for civil service posts. Under the premise of level playing field, the administration should not give priority to NCSC staff in open recruitment exercises. However, because they have experience in the government departments, in general, in the recruitment exercise, they enjoyed an advantage. For example, between 2017-2018 in August, the successful rate for NCSC staff in recruitment exercise was 15%, far more than the 3% in general. About 9,300 NCSC staff were recruited as civil servants during the period. Members also showed concern about the conditions of service and the pay package for NCSC staff. We need to do periodic reviews on the salary of the staff to ensure the employment package remains competitive in order to retain them. We understand that the pay adjustment of NCSC staff are comparable to the civil service pay adjustment in general. Quite a lot of government departments even offer employment package more than or better than those under the employment ordinance, such as the number of leave days entitled and also gratuity payments. Earlier, Chairman and also Mr. Ho Kai-ming at the panel suggested that improvements be made on NCSC staff taking leave on public holidays to enhance the arrangement starting from the from April next year. 17 days of paid annual leave will be provided to NCSC staff. The head of bureaus and departments will continue to review the mechanism and, depending on the actual circumstances, replacing the NCC positions by civil service posts. That concludes my presentation. I'm happy to take questions from members. We have Mr. Ho Kai-ming, Mr. Peng Xiaoping, Mr. Ip Kin Yun, waiting to ask questions. 5 minutes each. Thank you, Chairman. I think over the years, we have felt how the policy would affect the public as well. For example, according to the code, we are required to be politically neutral. But I think last year, when the SFAA handled the cash handout of $4,000, the public lodged a lot of complaints. I don't know whether these are on short-term contracts. I won't blame them. I don't know whether there are ways for to help them. I mean, this is an ad hoc task with staff facing immense pressure. I have a question whether we should allow NCSC staff to handle this hot potato. I don't know whether there are ways to monitor the how they help execute government policies, because I don't know what happened, but over 1,000 forms were missing. Indeed, much resources were spent on recruiting NCSC staff. I shouldn't blame them, but the Civil Service Bureau should also explain how they're going to improve things. Next, in the recent District Council election, again, doubts were cast on how the operation was carried out, and coincidentally, this department also engaged a large number of civil service or non-civil service contract staff. In fact, according to the paper, the REO hired 555 NCSC staff, whereas civil servants only accounted for 57. One third of the establishment is in fact NCSC staff. How do we make sure that these staff members would carry out government policies? Because one third of the whole department or the office was in fact non-civil servants. So Secretary, what can be done to make sure that they would execute government policies? And for short-term ad hoc requests such as the $4,000 cash handout or electoral matters, it's really high pressure job. What else can be done instead of just relying on NCC staff? Thank you for your question. About the two departments you referred to, the nature of the work is rather long term. Rather short term, and it cannot be dealt with by civil service posts. And I think Mr. Ho's question is how we can make sure that government policies are upheld. In fact, for all NCC staff, they are required to pledge allegiance to the government in executing government policy. So they also need to follow the CSR, yes, but what is their punishment should they fail to comply? This will be dealt with according to the disciplinary mechanism of individual departments. I'm sure what we need to look at is, first of all, how these applicants are recruited and selected and the training available so that they can have a full grasp of what is required of them at work in delivering a service, and also how the department monitors the staff members' performance. Mr. Ho referred to missing forms. In fact, the office is reviewing the situation and see how this can be dealt with. As for the registration electoral office, because it is the electoral year, say in next year in September, there will be another major election, and hence the need to recruit a large number of NCSC staff to help out. But like I said, in terms of recruitment, selection, training, monitoring, and the handling of complaints, departments will follow up on all these matters. I don't think the Secretary gets my point. I don't think they accord great priority to making sure that civil NCSC staff would execute government policies. I think you should refocus your strategy. Next, Mr. Pun Siu-peng. There are over 10,000 NCSC staff at the moment, and there is a concern why, having worked in the department for a long time, they remain NCSC staff, and according to the paper, the positions cannot be replaced, and there are some 3,300 of them, and they had worked for 5 years or more in civil service. And it is said that next year the leave arrangements will be aligned with other civil servants. I want to know whether other aspects will also be aligned, such as promotional prospects. And Mr. Ronnie Chen, who just left, wanted to ask another question. For FEHD, LCSD, on average, they employed more than 1,000. And also Department of Health, some 300. It's number 8 on the list. For those with 5 years of continuous service, 120, and then 10 years or more, 170. Now, his question is, why have these staff members worked for such a long time in the post? Well, of course, we don't agree. We feel that the positions should be replaced, and we understand during SARS, a lot of temporary posts were also created. With the upcoming economic downturn and possible rise in the employment rate, against this backdrop, we want to know whether the government has given it a thought for the time being. Secretary, thank you for the question. About the pay package and conditions of service, at the time of recruitment, the candidates are clear about them. We cannot compare the pay package of NCSC staff with that of civil servants. They are of completely different systems. There is no arrangement of promotion as such. Well, since the member asked about promotional aspect, if the performance is good, then there may be another NCSC post with higher pay and at a more senior level, and they may have the caliber to apply and be recruited. I mentioned four conditions or four scenarios in my opening remarks, and should any of these four scenarios arise, there may be a need to engage more NCSC staff. The Education Bureau and Hong Kong Post also have their respective representatives here, and if members are interested to know why they need more NCSC staff, I am sure they'll be happy to answer members' questions. As for economic downturn and whether this is a reason we should create more temporary posts, well, operational need is the main factor in deciding whether civil service or indeed NCSC posts should be created. If there is operational need, then it may be justified to create posts. Otherwise, it poses a difficulty because we should be accountable to the public. Since we are on public offers, we need to make sure that services required to be provided to the public. Otherwise, it will be really difficult for us to create posts. But during SARS, the administration indeed created temporary posts. I'm not going to argue with you on that. And anyway, last time we also discussed some NCSC staff members had worked for more than 10 years in the same position. Have you reviewed the practice? Say the Department of Health, over 100 of them work for 10 years continuously. Perhaps I will invite the PS to give you an answer. For the Department of Health, 223 of them provided health surveillance service on a contract basis at cross-border checkpoints. But after a review was conducted, these posts were gradually phased out, a drop of 76%. However, time is needed to avoid a drastic change and also for striving for resources. Mr. Kim Yun, well, before Mr. Kim Yun begins, Mr. Ip, I submitted the paper setting out some reference information about the figures that he asked for during special FC meetings and earlier panel meetings for comparison with the paper. Thank you, Secretary, for replying to my question on the 6th of December. He's provided quite a lot of figures, and the administration has signed public offices of departments with more NCAC staff to answer our questions.
My question, mainly about the Education Bureau. The Education Bureau was among the three major departments that employ the greatest number of contract staff, but now is among the two largest departments. And now the Education Bureau and Hong Kong Post are employing the largest number of contract staff. We can understand the needs of the Hong Kong Post, but for the Education Bureau, I fail to understand why it has to employ more than 1,000 contract staff, accounting for about 10% of the total number of NCSC staff employed by the government. Now, the format provided here is a bit different from what it was provided in the budget. Now, on the 6th of December, there was a reply from the CSB with an annex, and in there I can find the situation related to the Education Bureau. Now, there is a breakdown. Under the Education Bureau, we have this category, education worker. What are they exactly? I believe most under the Education Bureau would be educational workers. And then non-technical staff, what are they? If we read this together with the reply provided in for the budget purpose, 400 all of them, or 48 of them was provided. Is it the same as the reply provided the budget? 349 teaching assistants. So, why should teaching assistants be considered as posts that are time limited and seasonal or with market fluctuations? Will they only be employed for just a few months or for the whole year? So I'd like to know whether teaching assistants form part of this category, and non-technical staff, 297. Are under the category where the mode of delivery of service is under review or may be changed. Will that cover 222 artisans? And the mode of delivery of service by artisans is under review and will be changed shortly. So can you elaborate on the two categories, educational workers and non-technical staff? Thank you. Thank you, Chairman, and thank you, Mr. Yip. Mr. Yip asked about the number of education workers in Education Bureau. Now, teaching assistants are part of them. And there were about 300 odd, as said, 30th of June 2019. They are employed on an academic year basis. They are time limited, and because Public schools have school-based management. Schools have greater autonomy to deploy the resources more flexibly. So usually, they're employed from September every academic year until the end of the academic year. 90% of them are employed for 12 months. A small number of them might be shorter than 12 months, perhaps due to needs of the schools concerned, or perhaps the start of their contract did not tally with the start of the academic year. But most of them will be employed for 1 year. Because the contracts are signed every academic year. And as for non-skilled staff, most of them are artisans or janitor staff. They are mainly employed by government schools which have school-based management. They are allowed to spend or use their resources flexibly. There is a scheme for them to use their funds flexibly, depending on the needs. At different times of the year, schools can have a different staff mix. So the money under the fund can be used for employing NCSE staff. They are mainly janitor staff or clerical workers, and they can even outsource the workers. The Bureau reviewed the staff mix of government schools on an annual basis. We encourage our schools to turn NCSE positions to civil service posts if work will be for the long term. And NCSE staff can be turned to civil service staff. Under the flexible use of funds scheme, 118 janitor staff members and clerical workers have become civil servants. Another 39 was reached in the beginning of this academic year. So we do have regular reviews. Mr. Yip Kin Yun. All right, if no other members are waiting to ask questions, I'd like to have a go in the second round. Yes, please do. So the PAS, reply was in line with my understanding. For janitor staff, in fact, there was a reduction from 301 to 222 in 2018. So indeed, they have this trend to turn such staff to civil service positions. But for teaching assistants, it's a bit different. According to information given to us in the budget, now because there is a comparison there, in 2014, 258 and 349 in 2018, up almost 100. For teaching assistants and non-skilled staff, they are being employed by government schools under school-based management. So government schools employ a very large proportion of NCSE staff. And we're quite worried about the situation of teaching assistants. The PAS said that a minority of them, maybe about 10% of them, were employed for less than 11 months. And Ms. Min said that perhaps their contract did not start in September. But we've heard that some of them were employed starting from September, but the contracts did not cover the summer vacation. And this is very mean. Perhaps this is not necessarily happened in government schools, we need to have more information to confirm. But if this is real, I hope the Bureau can reconsider this. Teaching assistants should not be employed in this manner. About 90% of them have been employed for 12 months. Now they are regarded as positions that are time limited. But if the contracts are renewed, that means their positions are not time limited. And I understand that teaching assistants are regularly needed in schools. So can they be employed as NC, as a CS staff? I'd like to know whether they can be employed continuously. Thank you. EDB. Thank you. Mr. Yip referred to teaching assistants being employed for less than a year. The EDB has been reminding government schools, so I believe these schools have taken care of the interests of teaching assistants. Usually, if a teaching assistant can be successfully employed before the 1st of September, the contract will start from September until the end of the summer vacation. So they are usually employed with a 12-month contract. I said more than 90% in the past 3 years. Over 90% of the teaching assistants in the past 3 years lasted 12 months. Less than 10% of them had a shorter than 12-month contract because their contracts did not start in September. Because according to school principals, some of the teaching assistants that got an offer did not turn up in September, and so they had to employ another batch of teaching assistants to fill the posts. As for situations other than in public school, government schools, I will relate this back to my Bureau so that even subvented schools will take care of the interests of teaching assistants. Now for government schools, they have school-based and management. The teacher mix and the manpower mix is within their autonomy. Because teaching assistants very often help teachers to prepare teaching materials and organize activities. We have many new education initiatives and also funding schemes for schools, and therefore there is a greater demand for the service of teaching assistants, and that explains why there has been an increase in the number of teaching assistants because of teaching of education initiatives and funding, and such positions are really time limited and seasonal, and that's why teaching assistants are being employed SNCSC staff. Having said so, we from time to time review the manpower situation of schools, and we encourage government schools to employ long-term staff as far as possible, but we have more than 60 government schools. And the teacher mix may be different every year. There may be a reduction in such positions and addition elsewhere, and if the same staff member has been employed continuous for a few years, well, we will review the situation. If we see a service need for some position, if it is projected to be need for the long term, we'll turn it to an CS position.
At the same time, for different activities and subjects, additional staff members may be required by the school. This may be employed by the school itself. So for teaching assistants, remaining for the same position for a long time, we do keep in view the situation. Mr. McKeon, it's all right for you to ask more questions if no other members are waiting, but we have a another member waiting. Oh, about the years of service, can you give me a breakdown? How many of them 5 years, how many 3 years, etc.? Mr. Peter Shu, thank you. I have a question for the Hong Kong Post. As I understand, you're supposed to be self-sufficient. You're supposed to look after your staff arrangements depending on how much profit you make. But I understand at the moment at the post office, some of your staff members are still civil servants. First of all, is that correct? For the civil servant staff in Hong Kong Post, is it that no more government funding is required and that you will manage on the self-sufficiency principle? Perhaps I can give you a brief answer and then the Hong Kong Post colleague can supplement. The Hong Kong Post operates on a trading fund, and as such, the expenditure will be drawn up in a light of actual situation, whether the revenue can cover the expenditure. It differs from among trading funds, but perhaps I can defer to the Hong Kong Post to take your question. Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Shu, for your question. Indeed, we have a trading fund. We also keep the existing arrangement for civil servants. So we continue to employ civil servants as well as non-civil servant staff. And we operate on a self-financing basis. And we have been operating at a loss. So despite the losses and the deficit you run into, you still manage to keep yourself afloat without government help. We have different business direction that we're exploring in the long term. Indeed, we should be able to find our way, but at the moment, as of last year, we recorded a deficit. You have property, is that right? Or rather, you operate on different premises, but you don't own any property. Do you pay rent or what? We have venues available through different channels. Some are allocated by the government. Some are hired on the basis of rent trading fund, and we also rent from, say, Link Reed shopping malls, private property owners. We operate post counters depending on demand. Are there government venues free of charge currently used by the Hong Kong Post? We have 26 post offices operating on government properties on this principle. It's free of charge. No rent will be charged if it is under the Hong Kong Post. But rent will be charged at market value if it is government property, not under the Hong Kong Post. You run on a self-financing basis, is that right? In other words, it's like a business for us. I don't think we should blame you, because fewer people send letters nowadays. We have different technologies, and your clientele is shrinking. This is the same as news agents. Business is dwindling, and there may be other ways, say for them to sell other items other than newspapers so as to survive. I understand perhaps it is the government's duty to provide postal service, even if it is not profitable. But back then, when the government decided that you should set up a trading fund and operate on your own, you had to find your own ways. And it's really a concession for you. You could operate on over 20 premises without rent. Have you considered new ways, such as the SF Express? It is making such a huge profit now. You need to, say, provide courier service. They can hire a ground floor shop and operate successfully because of the change of mode of operation. Just like the general post office, imagine the huge space. If you're required to pay rent, you would have folded up long ago. So if you're not really interested in improving your business, you should just sell it. If you continue to run into a huge loss, and if you come and ask for funding assistance, should we help or not? Because you've known at this stage that demand for postal service is dwindling, and you also adhere to the civil service structure. And if one day you fold up, well, what should we do? So next time when Hong Kong Post attends our meeting, you should tell us how you're going to make it profitable. Well, stamp collecting is no longer a hobby. Fewer people collect stamps, not so much the demand in postal service. Mr. Lam Cheuk-ting, I have a question for the Secretary, in fact, two questions. To follow up on Mr. Im Kin Yun's question, I also received complaints from contract teachers in government schools. School principals would withhold the decision whether to renew the contract or not all the way till summer holiday. And teachers are indecisive about whether to start job hunting or not. These teachers are well qualified. Unless there is any special reason, schools should tell teachers whether they will be renewed well beforehand, so as not to make it difficult for these teachers to find new jobs and to make them anxious. It is undesirable. Chairman, the next point is about RTHK. There are lots of NCSE and outsourced staff. And in the past 6 months, as we all know, they're required to be dispatched for reporting duties. With shortage of manpower, they face a lot of pressure. And earlier, they also took up the role of TV broadcasting without much additional resources. They are under a lot of pressure. So, Secretary, regarding RTHK, NCSC staff switching to civil service posts, can you expedite the process? And are there sufficient resources to tide them over such hard times so that they can fulfill the obligation as a public broadcaster to provide real-time information to the public as well as the government? Secretary, There are two questions. Perhaps I should start by saying something about the RTHK, and then the Education Bureau can also elaborate on the point of government school teachers. For RTHK, if there is a need to have more equipment or manpower, there is a mechanism which they could follow. They could raise it to the government, and we can see if we could provide support in terms of resources. Be it in recent times or in the past, this request can be made if there is need, and there is a mechanism to handle such a request. As to whether we should convert NCSE posts to civil service posts, we need to first consider whether there is a long-term operational need which makes it suitable for these posts to be converted. All along, the RTHK also has been establishing new CS posts. For example, 98 CS posts were created between 2017 and 2019 to replace NCSE posts with long-term operational needs. I understand that the RTHK will continue to conduct regular reviews about the employment of NCSE staff. In 2019-2020, the RTHK has been given the approval to create 16 CS posts, and they have been preparing for the recruitment exercise. Education Bureau can supplement on the next question. Thank you, Chairman. For contract teachers in public schools, they are not employed on the condition applicable to NCSE staff. They are usually substitute teachers or temporary teachers to fill certain vacancies. For substitute teachers, they are hired to stand in for teachers who are on maternity leave or on sick leave. As for temporary teachers that whose contract could be renewed, they are employed by government schools to replace or to fill regular vacancies lasting for more than 60 days. We also have teachers employed on temporary funding available. I do not have information at hand, but for rather long-term contract teachers in government schools, in recent years, because of the abundance of resources, many such posts have been created. So for government schools, if they've employed a teacher in a school year, they will need to consider what resources are available, whether teachers would be required, and this could not be done until towards the end of the semester. However, once the schools has worked out the sum, for example, whether teachers should be kept, renewed, or I understand that there is keen competition, and I understand they do tell the teachers as soon as possible. They are not really NCSE staff. But anyway, I will relay your view and for the schools to note.
I will extend the meeting by 15 minutes using my powers to the chairman. Just one sentence. Chairman, I hope the bureau can really see to this, because some teachers told me that the contracts have been extended for or renewed for a few years. While administration said that there was a great demand for such personnel, and it was not difficult for teachers to switch posts. So please check it out for us. Now, can you really advise schools, given the school-based management initiative? You have to be honest with teachers. You have to tell us clearly whether the school or the bureau can decide. Well, schools have school-based management, but the bureau can need to approve resources for employment of teachers every year. All right, now it's my turn. My question is very simple. The secretary said that because Mr. Ho Kai-ming and I raised this issue, NCSE staff will enjoy 17 days of general holidays starting from the next financial year. In fact, Ho Kai-ming and I asked for more than 17 days because you should treat your NCSE staff properly, because according to NXD, there are 3,314 full-time NCSC staff that have worked for 5 years or more. And in Note 2, we can see that 1,000 out of the 3,000-odd staff members have been engaged in different NCSC positions within the same department. I don't know whether that was a deliberate arrangement. They have been working in the same department, and yet they could not stay in the same position, and they've been posted to different positions. Why have you deprived these NCSC staff of benefits than entitled to using this method? Well, they cannot be switched to SE staff at once. Shouldn't you give them fringe benefits in terms of a period of leave and medical benefits as their CS staff? Because they have worked in the same department for so many years, that means they are not part-time workers. Why are you so mean when it comes to benefits they enjoy? NCSC staff may be engaged in different NCSC positions within the same department. All these positions do not have long-term need, and therefore, after completing the contract in one position, and when other positions arise and they're interested, they may be transferred to other positions. And they might be interested in other NCSC positions. There is no question of our deliberately keeping NCSC staff in our department for a long time so that they cannot become CS staff. Because, as I said in my opening remarks, NCSC positions can only be maintained for the four situations I said. They are positions that cannot be filled by CS positions. We cannot compare their pay and benefits with CS staff because civil servants are subject to a whole package of management rules and regulations, and NCS staff are also managed with their own set of regulations. We said that on a discretionary basis, we should provide NCS staff with terms more favorable than what are provided in the employment ordinance. And if NCSE staff are interested in CS positions as they arise, and if they fulfill the requirements, then according to our records, their success rate was over 15%. They usually enjoy a higher rate of success than non-NCSC candidates. And if they can successfully switch to CS terms, then they can enjoy CS benefits. Now, this is the first time you have used all sorts of excuses. Well, you keep saying that there must be a distinction between NCS staff and CS staff. I must say that for NCSC staff that have been employed for a long time should be cherished and recognized. And as I said, Mr. Ho Kai-ming and I asked for more than giving 17 days of general holidays to NCSC staff. Even non-NCSC staff can enjoy 17 days of general holidays. So why do you give the same to outsourced workers? Because above the one third of the labor force do not enjoy 17 days of general holidays, and I think some of them, 20 to 30% of them, are engaged in government contracts, and because they work as outsourced workers, they cannot enjoy 17 days of general holidays with pay. Can the government take the lead so that everyone in the workforce can enjoy the same? And I think you should extend these 17 days of general holidays were paid to outsourced workers. I'm afraid the topic of this agenda is the terms and conditions of service for NCSC staff, and I heard your acknowledgement of our effort in giving 17 days of general holidays were paid to NCSC staff. As for outsourced workers, they are not government employees. We are users of services they provide, and therefore we cannot provide them with employment benefits. These benefits should be provided by companies that employ them. And it's quite common that these outsourced workers are serving or providing services both to the government and other companies in the private sector. So it is difficult for us to dictate what employment terms contractors should give to outsourced workers. It is entirely a contract between these outsourced workers and their employers. I think you know full well that these outsourced workers are paid by the government, and if you are willing to pay a little bit more, they'll be able to enjoy 17 days of paid general holidays. Mr. Yip Kin-yun, I think it is important that contract teachers be informed as to whether the contracts will be renewed in the next school year, because I have received many complaints from teachers, even those serving subvented and government schools, that notification came too late. So I hope the Bureau can remind school heads and SMCs that they adopt this employee-friendly practice. According to information we have within the Education Bureau, we see an ever-increasing number of NCSE staff in categories such as audiologists, psychologists, and also IT staff. In 2014, there were 53 IT staff, and then it rose to 186 in 2015. And because of the promotion of STEM curriculum, I think this will be a regular policy. And audiologists and clinical psychologists or educational psychologists, the number rose from 14 in 2014 to 35 in 2015. I'd like to know whether you have the plan to turn these staff members or these positions to permanent CS posts. First, teaching assistants. As at the 30th of June 2019, we had 372 teaching assistants working as teaching assistants. Only 23 of them had been working for over 5 years in these positions. And as for IT staff, we have increased funding for employing IT staff. We have an IT staff support allowance and also another allowance to promote IT in school. And so schools will see for themselves how the allowances should be used. They may employ more IT staff because schools have to use their resources flexibly, and that will be reflected in their staff mix. The funding is time limited, and so schools can only employ IT employees with contracts. And as for audiologists and educational psychologists, well, they're being employed as NCSE staff because they are on a temporary basis, because we have created permanent positions in the Bureau. Pending the filling of these vacancies, schools are using NCSE contracts to employ these personnel. We are still recruiting, and when these vacancies are filled by civil servants, we'll cut the number of NCSE audiologists and psychologists. So these positions are limited because you cannot get permanent ones. Is it because the pay and conditions offered for psychologists cannot compete with the private sector? And for IT coordinator, you are using short-term allowances to employ them.
The government's policy is to allow an annual funding, and you will utilize the funding based on your own decisions. Can you change it to recurrent funding instead, so that you can keep regular staff? And that's the key. Can you answer that? A short one? Well, this is about funding. I do not have information. Yes, please go back and give Mr. Ip Kin Yoon a written reply. That's the end for this item. Last item, AOB. Any AOB? If not, the meeting will adjourn here. Merry Christmas to all.